This story speech is about one dog, my dog, named Brownie, who is one little annoying Pomeranian dog. My dog's name is Brownie. He is 7 years old and is one little annoying Pomeranian dog to live with. The first aggravating thing that my dog does is every time I buy my own vanilla ice cream cone from McDonald's and place it on my table, he snatches it right off the table, and when you look, it's already have been snatched off. Also, the really silly thing my dog does is he will dance around the whole living room if he needs to go to the bathroom or jump up on me when I am doing something on the computer or anything. The most terrifying and disgusting thing my dog does is he eats underwear. And he goes under my bed and chews on foil and swallow it. He eats my underwear, my grandma's underwear, and my mom's underwear. One time he even went into the garbage can and stole a moldy slice of pizza with fat mold all over it. He got yelled at by my grandma and would not look at her during a lecture. Even when I feed my dog his food and water, he splashes the whole water all over the floor and makes me have to clean it up. Well, I do not like having to do that. Also, when my dog sees a big dog somewhere, like at the park, he pees on the floor and jumps up on my grandma's bed. He acts like a wimp and a crazy maniac. Also, every time I buy my dog toys, he doesn't even like to play with them, the toys I bought him. And it makes me feel funny because he is acting like Greg Heffley from Diary of a Wimpy Kid, who is so boring. Every time I would take my dog to a park or anywhere with other people or dogs, he would always bark at the dogs, and it's rude and very disrespectful to the other people at the park who are playing sports or something. I do love my dog no matter what. I hope to spend more and more years with my dog and take him for walks and have fun with my dog Brownie. I always love my dog Brownie, even though he gets on my case and wants me to make me pull my hair out. And this is my story.
Getting ready to graduate from fifth grade, and I'm excited. No, really, I am. Okay, not convinced. Well, let me explain maybe why I'm just a bit hesitant. Riverage, the Royal Knights, big school, lots of new friends, switching classes, cheering, drama, all the things I love and look forward to. Sounds great, right? But there's just one thing. And please, don't get me wrong. I love this person like a dad. Well, okay, you got me. He is my dad. I've been told. Girls think he looks like Pauly D.
Yeah, buddy!
It's already starting. Tell your dad I said hello. Oh, please, if there was an award for class clown, my dad would own that award. That's great, and he's really funny. But when you're a girl and your dad is the infamous Dark Knight and now the Mayhem Guy wearing a pink sweatsuit running around campus? No, really, I'm not joking. These characters are his alter ego. No comment. And yes, he sings a song called the Kylie Girl Song. It's been thrown into my sack since I can remember. It goes something like this. I'm a Kylie girl in a Kylie world. It's fantastic. My world is plastic. Okay, you get the picture. Someday it might have to work his way into my class and belt out a song. And that's when you'll find me down at the principal's office begging for a transfer. So by now you probably figured out my dad's a teacher at River Ridge.
Yeah, that means I'll see him everywhere. At lunch, in the halls, at specials.
There goes my social life, and you can just forget about any boyfriends.
But with everything said and all the silliness aside, he's a pretty cool dad, and I will always love him. And I know for sure that I'll always be my dad's little girl. But I have 7 more years to go. Good grief. No, I'll never get rid of him. Love you, Dad.
When I walked up to this giant, I was excited, but very nervous. The giant was so scary that even my dad was afraid of it. The giant stood there, 150 feet tall. I heard the giant roar and felt the ground rumbling under my feet. I could hear the terrified screams of those that went before me. And before I knew it, it was my turn. I was at a point that I couldn't breathe, but I could not turn back now. So I climbed up on top of the beast and secured my position. I held on so tightly that my knuckles became white. To my surprise, the giant moved smoothly and slowly forward. The giant lifted me up over the hills. Then the giant threw me down to the ground. I let go of my grip and I screamed at the top of my lungs. Then, right before I hit the ground, the giant scooped me up and turned me upside down. I thought I might be sick. He did this over and over again. Then, as suddenly as it began, it was over. The giant gently brought me back to where I began and let me go. That's when I realized that I didn't have the giant. The giant had me. It turns out this giant wasn't mean and scary at all. It really only wanted to play with me. What was the name of this giant, you ask? Montu, one of the most famous roller coasters at Busch Gardens of Tampa Bay, Florida. And like I said, this was just the first giant I conquered. I went on to conquer many, many, many more. Like Guazi, Cheetah Hunt, Kumba, and the biggest one of them all, Sheikra.
Imagine you're soaring above the canopies, flying high above the birds. Doesn't this sound awesome? Why did all of this just 8 months ago when I went ziplining over the rainforest? Now I'll tell you a few things about my trip to Islerotan, Honduras, which is a country in Central America. First of all, we had to take a long ride up to the top of the mountain, which took about 40 minutes. But we got to see a lot of cool scenery, like huge mountains and treetops. When we got there, we had to wait on a wooden ledge for about 20 minutes. To pass the time, though, they had a toucan and a monkey in a cage. I played with them until it was time to go. Then, before we left, we had to get on helmets, gloves, and safety belts. Then, it was time to rock and roll. My grandpa, who is 71 years old, was first. I watched him as I was ready to be the next one, shot off the wooden ledge, straight into the rainforest. I was a little nervous, but not as much as my sister, who was very jittery. Now, it was my turn. First, they attached my safety belt onto the 2 strong cables. Then, the guy showed me how to stop at each platform. Then he shoved me off. I went soaring through the air, screaming, "This is awesome!" I zipped from platform to platform, 16 platforms in all. But before the last zip, they warned us this was the longest zip, at the length of 1,300 feet and at the height of 120 feet. If we didn't land on this last platform, we'd end up in the ocean. I was nervous, but when I landed on that last platform, I was ready to go again. After After everyone got off, we went and got our pictures from the awesome ziplining adventure. They took it from a distance, though, but it almost looked as if my sister posed for every picture. Like this, this, and this. The rest of our pictures turned out great, too. And that was my awesome ziplining adventure. Hope you get to do it someday, too.
From my perspective, I like being myself, but not everyone feels the same way about themselves. When we were younger, it seemed so much easier to be ourselves and to fit in. Today, things are not as simple. We've had necessary discussions in our guidance classes about how to handle peer pressure, bullying, and fair fighting. These discussions are helping us to have a better chance at being ourselves in the future. My parents had never heard of fair fighting, so I gave them some examples of fair fighting. When you are fair fighting with someone, you cannot bring up the past, you cannot threaten, and you have to be willing to hear the other person's side of an argument. Fair fighting encourages us to solve our own problems. Peer pressure is when others ask you to do something even though they know that it is wrong. Do kids give in to peer pressure because they want to be liked, or is it that they want to fit in, or because they don't want to be made fun of, so they go along with the group to avoid being called names? I'm not sure the reasons why, but I do know that we all have been taught that it is okay to say no. Bullying is using forceful behavior to get power. Bullying can happen in many different ways. Some kids bully by hitting others, gossiping, or saying unkind words. Until recently, I had never been bullied. But as I get older, kids are making fun of me because I'm small. My response is that I'm okay with my height because it's part of who I am. I might become the next Marty St. Louis who plays hockey for the Lightning. Marty's not very tall either, but he is very successful. I wish that peer pressure and bullying didn't exist, but it does. How do we stop it? What's the answer? How can we fit in and be ourselves? Perhaps we can remember strategies that we have been taught by our teachers and parents, have goals, volunteer to help others, continue to surround ourselves with people who care about us as we care for them. And we really have to remember that we all have special gifts and talents.
Imagine this. You're in a car with a pillow strapped against your seatbelt and a baseball helmet on your head. That may sound a little weird, but that's exactly what I was wearing when my sister first started to drive. When my sister started driving, I have to admit, I was pretty scared. She had never drove before in her life. I heard a voice in my head screaming, "Safety hazard, safety hazard," so I had to prepare. I ran upstairs, grabbed a pillow off my bed, went in the garage, and got a baseball helmet with extra padding, and met my mom and sister in the car. Thankfully, my mom began to drive to show my sister what to do and where everything was. So I was safe for about 5 minutes, but then, dun, 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 I heard the words of my worst nightmare. My mom said, "So, are you ready to practice?" And by practice, she meant drive. Terrified as ever in the backseat, clenching my hands on the pillow, my sister put the car in drive and drove slowly around the circle until she saw the bright red stop sign. My sister switched from the gas to the brake. All I could say is it's a good thing I bought the helmet with extra padding. My head banged into the back seat. I felt like a bobblehead when the car reached a full stop. My sister was driving in the same circle for about an hour. There were no houses, no traffic, not one single car in sight. Just me, my sister, and my mom in one small car in the middle of July with no air conditioning. Not that we didn't have air conditioning. Apparently, it made my sister's hands cold, and that was just one of her rules while she was driving. She didn't let me or my mom turn on the radio, and I wasn't allowed to say a single word. And that was very hard for me. I loved to talk. After an hour and a half of driving, my mom finally said that it was time to head home, which meant driving outside the circle. My sister panicked, but proceeded to follow my mom's commands. The roads we took home had a few stop signs. Again, my head jolted. We were approaching our house with only a few instructions. My sister managed to only park halfway on the grass. Pretty good for a beginner. When I got out of the car, I was relieved. The torture was finally over. It's been a little over a year since my sister first started to drive. I'm proud to say that when I'm driving with her, I no longer need a pillow or a helmet. But I advise you right now, if you have an older sibling and they're going to start driving, it's better to stay home. If you have no choice, just remember, bring a pillow and a helmet, and you should be fine.
Wow. I think a cloud from heaven exploded chocolatey goodness into my mouth. Is that the way you feel when you take a bite of Hershey's chocolate? Well, I don't know about you, but you get the point. But have you ever wondered how Hershey's chocolate came about? Or what Hershey's chocolate is like today compared to yesterday? Or even what the world would be like without Hershey's chocolate? Well, I know I thought about it, and I got some answers. And I'm just that generous to share those answers with you. Milton S. Hershey is the great man who invented Hershey's chocolate. Milton was born in Pennsylvania, 1857. His father wasn't around a lot, so he only went to school up until fourth grade. At 15, he was apprenticed by a candy maker. His first company was Lancaster Caramel Company, which was a huge success. After that, he realized he wanted to make candy for a living. His father was a worldwide salesman, and as he traveled with him, he picked up tons of unique milk chocolate recipes, and through trial and error, he created his very own recipe. And at the time, milk chocolate was a Swedish luxury, so making a milk chocolate company would be a new experience for the U.S. In 1905, Milton finished building what was the biggest chocolate factory in the whole world. After his success with Hershey's, he died in 1945 at 88 years old. Hershey's chocolate today is a lot different from the early 1900s. It started out with a chocolate bar. Now we have Kisses, Reese's, Kit Kats, Whoppers, Milk Duds. Man, I think I'm gonna have a scrunch just listening to myself. But I would really love to go back in time and try a bite of Milton's candy bars, one that he made himself. Do you know what the world would be like without Hershey's chocolate? Criminals would be roaming the streets without anyone to stop them. Our babies would be born without creativity or curiosity. The world would stop spinning and the sun would blow up. But the absolute worst of all, I would be sad. Just think about it. All of this torture would be happening because Milton S. Hershey never created his formula for Hershey's chocolate. Well, now you all know what a great and intelligent man Milton Hershey was. But seriously, guys, let's recognize what he did for us. He created the most delicious, most mouth-watering, most heart-stopping, most flavor-bursting milk chocolate candy bar the world has ever known.
Personally, I hate animal abuse, and I doubt any of you like it either. So let's take a vote. Raise your hand if you like animal abuse. Raise your hand if you don't like animal abuse. So we have our winner. If all of us worked together, there'd be a better chance for stopping animal abuse. But if one single solitary person tries by themselves, they most likely won't succeed. Animal abuse has been going on for years, and I can't stand to have to think about it. I bet some of you have seen that sad commercial where the puppy dog is in the cage looking at you with those sad little puppy dog eyes. Hello, people. Instead of looking at the dogs, look at the words it says loud and clear. Stop animal abuse. That poor puppy wouldn't even be in the cage with a cast on if it hadn't been abused in the first place. is probably screaming in the cage, help me, adopt me, adopt me.
Some people will tie a dog up to a tree and beat it with a stick. My grandma has a dog like that. She was abused, and someone took her in, but later on couldn't take care of her, so my grandma took her. Her front jaw overlaps her bottom one, and she is terrified of loud noises, especially on 4th of July. There are different types of animal abuse, just like there's different types of human abuse. There is physical abuse where the owner will beat the dog and traumatize him. There's also physical abuse by yelling at the animal for no apparent reason. You can also abuse an animal by not keeping the house clean and making sure it is a clean, safe environment. You can also abuse an animal by not making sure they have plenty of food and water. Have you ever heard of illegal dog fights? Well, I have. Most of them take place in New Mexico City. Some dogs are killed in these fights, and the worst part of it is that the people who bet on the dog that won get the money from it. And don't even get me started on dog races. You think they're so innocent and harmless, but the truth is, some owners will give the dog steroids. Steroids is a medicine that increases speed and muscle mass, but the dogs, it is life-threatening. It could kill them. So those of you who don't want your animals, don't just let them go on the street. Take it to your local SPCA or Humane Society.
Dance. To move to the rhythm of music. For me, it's much more than that. Dance is another way to express my feelings, and nothing could ever change that. Ever since I was 3 years old, I was twirling around the house in that purple and black leotard every single day. I had a dream, and I always strived towards it. And one day, it came true. I won my first ballet recital, and I've never stopped dancing since then. There are different styles of dance, like hip-hop, which started in the 1970s, jazz dancing, which started in the early 1920s, and modern dance, which started in the early 1900s. I wonder why they call it modern dancing when it started back in the 1900s. Still not sure what dance you should try? You could try hip-hop, which is always fun and upbeat and is usually performed with rap or hip-hop music. Jazz dancing can be anything from a happy and energetic dance to a dark and serious dance. Modern dancing is a free and expressive style of dance. Honestly, jazz is my favorite style of dance because there's many ways to perform jazz. For example, it could be a fast-paced dance, or it could be slow and mysterious. I enjoy dance for many reasons. Here's my top five. Number five, it's fun. If it wasn't fun, I wouldn't even be in dance. Number four, I go to competition. What's the point of practicing if you're not competing for something, right? Number three, it's the only time I get to wear my dance uniform. Number two, you're always learning new dances. I mean, who wants to see the same dance over and over and over and over again? I know I definitely would. And my number one reason why I like dance is I get to wear makeup. I can put on mascara, glitter, eyeliner, eyeshadow, or even a wig. If I wore any of this makeup anywhere else, well, without permission, I would be in big trouble. And always remember that dance isn't just for fun. It is another form of exercise, like Zumba dance workout, which was created in 2001. So, get off that couch, stop eating Fritos, turn off American Idol, and dance and have fun. By the way, if someone asks you, why in the world are you dancing around like a crazy monkey? Do not blame me.
Numismatics. Allow me to introduce myself. My name is Bill. I'm a small guy and quite thin. I wear linen and cotton with bits of red and blue silk. I have a long history. In my day, Latin was considered the universal language of educated men, and I picked up a few phrases such as animalculeptus and novus ordo seclorum. They say you can't change a man. There are 293 ways to change me. Over the years, my appearance has been altered until 1957, when things finally settled down and you know me as I am today. Although I usually work alone, there are others just like me. In fact, As many as 16 million of us infiltrate society each day. We hear from Washington and Fort Worth, Texas. I have many symbols and markings on me, but they aren't tattoos. Most of these symbols are in groups of 13. You will usually never see any rooms number 13 or any hotels or motels with a 13th floor, but I'm not superstitious. I am quite popular. On any given day, you can find me at a restaurant, a bank, a supermarket, or at a restaurant. I can even end up on a bus. Stores and menus have been named after. I've been owned, sold, and traded. I get touched and passed around a lot and can become quite germy. Ew. I travel all over the world. However, all this traveling wears me out, and after about 21 months, I'm ready to retire. For a small guy, I am also quite powerful. People work for me. They lie, steal, and cheat for me. In fact, it is said that I am the root of all evil, and as much as I try, I can't buy happiness. I don't grow on trees, but I do grow in the bank. Many people have tried to duplicate me at their own peril. I have been lovingly nicknamed Buck, Greenback, Moolah, Clams, Smackers, and Dope. Cha-ching, I am the dollar bill.
Spectacular sunsets, twisting water slides, singing, dancing, buffets, and lots of beautiful oceans. Do you know what I'm talking about? Ding, ding, ding. Correct. Magnificent cruise ships. I consider myself an expert since I've been on 9 cruises since I was born. So now I'd like to share with all of you my cruise adventures. First, let's start with all the fun activities you can do on cruise ships. You can see an amazing show, shop, see a movie, swim, or if you dare, rock climb 13 stories high above the sea and much, much more. Some of my fondest memories are when I went rock climbing, bowling, seeing the awesome Blue Man Group, and eating breakfast with Nickelodeon characters SpongeBob and Patrick. Cruise ships are also very cool because they can take you to tons of faraway exotic places like the Bahamas, the Caribbean, Europe, and many more. Then when you get to these places, there are even more spectacular things to do. For example, I swam in Mayan Cavern in Costa Maya, Mexico. I snorkeled off one of the largest and amazing reefs in Roatán Bay, Honduras, and visited ancient Mayan ruins in Belize. How's that for an adventure? One of my favorite places I visited was in Atlantis. It is in Nassau, Bahamas, where I played and kissed a dolphin there for the very first time. The last thing I want to talk to you about is cruise ships. I mean, food. I love this part because you can just eat and eat and eat every day, but then you can just leave the restaurant without having to pay a bill. Then you can get yummy ice cream, pizza, room service for 24 hours a day for free. You better bring your appetite. I hope the adventures I've shared with you have enticed you to go on a cruise. There are so many exciting places to see, adventurous things to do, and scrumptious foods to eat. Who wouldn't want to go cruising? I highly recommend going on a cruise. And if you've already been on one, why not plan another?
Do you know who the most important person to you is? Tara Strong is to me. Why? Because she has encouraged me to be just like her. She is an actress, a voice actress, and a singer. And many other things. She is mostly known for her voice acting. If you watch TV, you should know that. She should be important to you too. I want to be an actress, a singer, and a voice actress just because of her. She started voice acting at age 13. Dang, that's young. One of the first voice characters she played with Hello Kitty in Hello Kitty's Fairy Tale Theater. She was nervous at first. Normally people are a little nervous, but she was super nervous. Like I am right now. But a couple of takes later, she loved playing Hello Kitty. Not as much as she loved playing Melody from The Little Mermaid 2. She still plays Hello Kitty till this day. Tara Strong's acting career started when she volunteered to be a soloist at age 14. Soon, she became acting at the Yiddish Theater. She did not know Yiddish at all, but she memorized her lines phonetically. During the time, she also performed in the Toronto Jewish Theater. That's where she acted Night of the Stars. Now Tara Strong's singing career started when she was acting in the Night of the Stars and was featured in an audio tape for Lay Down Your Arms with a Hamden choir where she sang both English and Hebrew and at the featured, she repeated on February 10th, 2005. Now she mostly sings in cartoon, but you can still see her live today. Mostly I prefer her cartoon singing. So let me ask you a question. Who is the most important person to you? Tara Strong is to me. Why? Because she has encouraged me to be just like her. A voice actress, an actress, and a singer. I hope she has encouraged you too.
Nico, not now. Can't you see that I'm busy? Seriously, go away. Knock it off. Stop it. Sorry, that was my little brother. He can be so annoying. Hey, do you have a little brother? If not, you're lucky. Little brothers can totally be a nightmare. He never gives me any privacy, always makes such a mess. And time alone with my friends? Never. I can see by the look on your faces that you're still not clear on how annoying my little brother can be. So let me cut to the chase. First, my little brother totally gives me a lack of privacy. Like last week, when I was in the shower, I heard knock, knock, knock. Nico, not now. Suddenly, when I thought he was gone, I saw his giant watermelon head with those huge moon eyes staring at me nude. Also, when it's time for homework, all I hear is, Julia, help me with this. Julia, help me with that. Of course, I had to take time out of my own life to help that little devil turn on the TV. If you don't think that's bad enough, don't worry, I've got plenty more. Next talks about my brother's horrible eating habits. At dinner time, the TV goes off and it's nice and silent. No, not while I have Nico sitting next to me, chomping down on chicken like a hyena eating its kill. All I hear is slurp, burp, lurp. It is so disgusting to have to sit next to him every single night. When anyone first meets this monster, they say, "Aw, he's so cute. How do you hate him so much?" Yeah, but once you step into my house, he goes ballistic wild, jumping everywhere, screaming like an imbecile. Whenever my friends come over, Nico turns on his be like an idiot mode. He is rude, disgusting to be around, and totally hyper. Like last month, when my friend Abby came over, we decided to play Dogopoly. My brother just had to play. Yeah, and my mom let him too. Sometimes, there's no one to play with outside. Like one time, when no one was out, me and my brother kicked around the soccer ball and had ice cream and had a good time. Huh. I guess my brother isn't so bad after all. Never time alone with friends. He probably does this because I never run to spend quality time with just him. No privacy. Probably because he always wants to be with me. Messy eating. Probably because he's trying to make me laugh. I guess you can see my perspective from here on out. I do love my brother.
Whoa, when you mention middle school, I think scary. When I wonder about it, I get chills and my stomach, it ties in knots. I get so dizzy that the room starts to spin. But then I stop, take a nice deep breath. All I do is think of that one word, freedom. I like elementary school and all, but after being trapped here for 6 years, you get really sick of it. River Ridge, that's the school I want to go to when I'm in sixth grade. Not only do I want to go there because it has been a straight A school for a very long time, for all the fun activities and classes I would like to attend. Yeah, that's right, I did school choice. I have been hoping and praying to get into this school for such a long time. Dance, it's technically my life. If I didn't get in, that would mean no dance team for me. Athletic, that's another way to describe me. Soccer, that's my sport. The word soccer doesn't have a U in it, does it? So don't even try to mess with it. Drama, acting, that's what I love. Taking drama will help me become a better actress. Change, next year it's gonna happen to all of us, especially the girls. If you knew what I wear when I go to school every day, well, I already know next year's gonna be a completely different story. Since I don't want people to mistake me for a guy, a dude, whatever you wanna call it, I'm warning you now, don't be shocked when you see me next year and I'm wearing skirts and dresses and makeup and actually caring about my hair. It's also very upsetting leaving Calusa. At the same time, I'm ecstatic. What I think I'll miss most is friends, teachers, and our crazy dramatic days. Memories made and memories to come, I can't wait to move on. Sometimes when people, like kids or adults, hear the words move on, they might not want to at first. Not occasionally, but always, we need that little push. I can already tell you that next year is going to be so fun and it's going to be a blast. Meeting new people is something I strongly encourage you to try. Be yourself. Don't change because people influence you. Change because you want to. Here I come, Purple Night, so be prepared, River Ridge. Hopefully.
Don't you ever wonder why you're losing friends here and there? It's because they're not true friends. Do you have a friend? I do. I'm not talking about the one you sit by at lunch talking about boys. I'm talking about the one who's there for you all the time and who makes you laugh when you're sad or upset. I have a best friend, and her name is Brianna. Brianna makes me laugh so much. It's the best thing ever. After we came from Busch Gardens, she started laughing for no entire reason. Her laugh was so funny, I started laughing too. I love Brianna so much. She's hilarious. When I'm sad or upset, Brianna's always there for me. Like when my mom went to the hospital, Brianna was there for me on her phone, saying everything is going to be okay. When I'm sad or upset, she makes me laugh by saying unique and stupid jokes. Now, Brianna is so crazy. Here's an example. She wanted to go in the pool when it was freezing cold, like Antarctica. Here's another example. Brianna wanted to fight her dad, so we picked up the pillows and started to hit him. Pillows might not hurt, but we totally won him. Here's one more example. Brianna's so crazy, we made up a little rap called Besties. Well, here, I'll show you. We're the besties and we're a little feisty, but when we're together, we're like peanut butter and jelly. We're like red polka dots, cause we're so famous now. And when you roll on the floor and open up the door, you know what I see? 50 Cent staring at me. We're like sugar and spice and everything nice. But if you wanna mess with us, you better think twice. We're like ceviche, spicy and icy. Kids, please, this isn't a game. We just wanna rock through the Hall of Fame. You set yourself on fire, you still don't look as hot as us. Brianna might be crazy for a lot of reasons. But trust me, it won't fit on this page. Brianna might be erratic and out of her mind, but I still love her as a companion. As David Levithan once said, we always see our worst selves, our most exposed selves. We need someone else to get close enough to tell us we're wrong, someone we trust. That's why I have my best friend, Brianna, to guide each other and make our relationship last.
You throw a happy and chocolate bar outside the car window. Have you ever thought that an animal could eat and maybe die? Well, that doesn't sound too good, does it? Because pollution is the introduction of poisons into our natural environment that causes harm to living things. But some people pollute on purpose every day, and some people don't realize they are polluting. There are a lot of pollutions: air, water, land, noise, radioactive, and thermal. They all harm our environment and make it hard for living things like plants and animals to survive. So what can we do to save our environment and animals? Yuck, aren't you sick of seeing litter everywhere? If you litter, so many things can happen, like animals can mistake it for food, eat it, and maybe die. Is this really how you want to treat animals? Animals have been here since the beginning of time, so it's not our right to destroy their world. You can stop littering by putting garbage in a trash can. Smoking causes two bad things. Smoking pollutes the air and causes forest fires. If you throw cigarettes, lighters, or matches into the forest, it can cause forest fires. If there are a lot of forest fires, some animals can become extinct. If we kill all the trees and plants, you will lose oxygen for yourself and everyone else. Oil spills hurt sea life and birds the most because if oil gets on or inside their skin, it can kill them. It can cause dehydration, make them unable to fly and swim, and illnesses. Oil spills occur because people are not careful. It is very sad because oil spills take the longest to recover from because it costs a lot of money, time, and dedication to fulfill the efforts to clean the water. Technology can also be a source of pollution and create noise. We create nuclear bombs, we use radioactive material, even the smallest nuclear device can demolish an entire city by its blast, fire, and radiation. These weapons and their use have caused a lot of arguing in our world. We can lose money, lose homes, and lose loved ones. Did I give you enough reasons why pollution affects animals and the environment? Since it takes more time to fix and clean up the effects of pollution on our environment, doesn't it make sense to make a difference now and stop polluting the earth? Animals and the environment are things we need to survive, but if you don't treat them with respect, they aren't going to be here anymore. So the next time you wonder if you're polluting, just ask yourself, since when did the earth become our own personal trash can?
Have you ever had toxic chemicals flow into your body? I am not talking about drugs. I am talking about chemo. Chemo is a toxic chemical used for treating cancer. I would like to share with you the story of a 10-year-old student who had cancer, Ewing sarcoma. Let me tell you the story of his journey. At first, they thought it was a cyst, which looked like a ball of skin popping out of his chest. So they removed it and found it was the C-word, cancer. He immediately went to the hospital and met with the doctor to see if he could have toxic chemicals flow through his body, otherwise called chemo. From here, he needed some surgery to install something called a port. He was able to get his toxic treatment, chemo, now, without any problem. For the next year, he had a new friend called Mr. Ivypole. This friend held a very important bag of medicine. He even went to the house with him. Mr. Ivypole was a pain to wheel around, but he knew he was carrying bags of liquid to keep him hydrated. He found at home he was used to feed the boy. He found himself getting angry at Mr. Ivypole. And sometimes, the doctors, he just hated having his temper day in the hospital. He was feeling anger, sadness, fear, and alone. But through it all, he had his family, friends, and teachers. 30 days ago, that 10-year-old boy learned he didn't have the C word anymore. That little boy was me. Dylan Hanlon. Thank you.
When I came home from Grandma's house Easter morning with a basket full of candy, you should have seen the look on my mother's face. You would have thought I was eating 10 pounds of bacon, which, by the way, my grandpa says it makes your hair shiny. I tried to sneak the basket by her, but at my house, that's impossible. My mom is always concerned about keeping me healthy. Do you ever wonder how candy is made? Most candy is made from sugar that has to be blended at high temperatures. There are many additional ingredients in candy. These include nuts, eggs, butter, and sometimes food dye. So do you think it is better to eat brown M&Ms or red? My mom would say neither because they both contain the same amount of sugar and food dye. So let me ask you this. Does it ever annoy you when candy sticks to your teeth? How about Butterfingers, Laffy Taffys, or lollipops? Be very careful. Lollipops are cavities on a stick. Lots of cavities equals lots of visits to the dentist. Parents out there, do your kids go crazy after eating candy? Do you ever wonder if it's from too much sugar? Sugar may cause some kids to become hyperactive and also can contribute to many other things. If you would like the list of foods that are good for you, then today's your lucky day. First, I'm going to name five of the worst foods you can eat. These are donuts, french fries, soda, chips, and candy bars. We should eat these in moderation. Now I'm going to name five foods that are good for you. The first one is sweet potatoes, which are high in vitamins B and C. The second one is mangoes because they are high in fiber and low in calories. The third one is Greek yogurt, which has lots of protein. The fourth one is mangoes, the fourth one is salmon, which has omega-3s and vitamin D. The last one is blueberries, which contain anti-cancer properties and are really sweet and yummy. Even if you don't like healthy foods, your body does. My mom says I will thank her when I get older for teaching me how to eat healthy. One final thought. My mom says when Easter comes every year, and with my mom getting older, one year I will sneak a basket by her. A gentle word, a kind look, a good-natured smile can work wonders and accomplish miracles. William Hazlitt. Smiling is a natural ability. Don't waste time frowning, smile. When you smile, more people want to be around you because you are gratifying. Well, you may be thinking, at some point everyone has a bad day. Yes, that is true. But if you force a smile on your face, it brings up your mood, confidence, and your health. Proceeding, smiling is a natural ability. One of the most common things all around the world is smiling, no matter gender, origin, or religion. Although smiling is known everywhere, it is a known fact that women smile more than men, because as infants, females are more excited about life. Like I said, smiling is natural. So natural that all babies are born with the ability to smile, even the blind children. It's the one thing that everyone has in common. Some emotions, out of the surplus that there are, that smiling can represent are pleasure, approval, amusement, or interest. Continuing, did you know that smiling makes kids and adults want to be around you because you are winsome? Also, smiling is contagious. In Sweden, people who frown have a really hard time frowning because everyone else around them is smiling. People who smile make other people around them want to smile. Now here's the good part. If you need a job promotion or desperately want one, just smile. In the workforce, smiling makes you look more visually attractive and ebullient. But here's a tip, have a real smile, because humans can tell a real smile from a fake smile just from the expression in the eyes. For example, a fake smile has a squint to the eyes, while a real sincere smile has a twinkle. Moving on, smiling boosts your immune system as well as your physical health. Your body is more relaxed when you smile, which contributes to good health and a stronger immune system. That's why you should show your pearly whites instead of frowning. Also, scientists have discovered that your body has to work harder to use more muscles to frown than to smile. Another health fact is that smiling reduces your blood pressure. There is a huge difference between the blood pressure of someone who frowns from someone who smiles. They are totally different. Concluding, smiling is a natural ability that takes no work whatsoever. When you smile, more people want to be around you because you have a good attitude and a great vision about life. Lastly, if you force a smile on your face when you are upset, it brings up your mood, confidence, and your health. So, for all you people who used to frown, turn that frown upside down.
What's the biggest deal with kids nowadays? No, it's not drugs or abuse. Believe it or not, it's bullying. In the year 2011, there was a record of 9 children that committed suicide just from bullying. Bullying just plain out stinks, believe me. I'm the type of girl that gets bullied for stupid things like for me being adopted or my clothes not being all that I need. There are different types of bullying. There is physical, mental, and cyberbullying. Physical bullying happens a lot, but not as much as cyberbullying or mental bullying. Mental bullying is where kids like to spread rumors, call other kids names, or curse them out. Cyberbullying happens the most because people nowadays have Facebooks, Twitters, Tumblrs, even YouTube is used. I've seen people take slow-running kids' pictures from yearbooks and put the background music shoes and say, try not to laugh. I mean, come on, is that necessary? People also post things on the internet or Facebook for anyone to see. Really, now if people have something to say about you, they need to say it to your face. When people get bullied, it's very painful. Bullying feels like knives dropping to you. Bullying takes away self-pride, and when you do that to that person, is 9 chances out of 10 either going to commit suicide or skip school. Bullying can cause loneliness or depression. Bullying damage people just by you using your words unkindly or your acts of unkindness. Bullies bully because they're either jealous, makes themselves feel good, or they want something. Now, I get bullied for stupid things. Don't ever let it get to you. Like my sister Connie sometimes says, let the haters keep on hating. Now, bullying needs to stop. I'm sure we all can agree. Now, I know people who in this room are rumor spreaders, and yes, you know who you are. But one thing I don't quite get is we are about to be somewhat mature fifth graders and soon in middle school, and we still are spreading rumors and physical bullying people? That's for kindergartners, not us. All I have left to say is stop the bullying. I have one solution. If you ain't got nothing else to say, don't say it at all.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen, or should I say, hikers and explorers. We are now going to be traveling to Arizona. We are going to Arizona to see the Grand Canyon. It's one of the 7 natural wonders of the world. Have you ever seen the Grand Canyon? First of all, it is not, I repeat, not just a big hole in the ground. It's a canyon, and it's the largest one in the world. 277 miles long and 18 miles wide. Now that's huge. If you don't know what a canyon is, it's a valley narrow and long with high cliffs on each side. The river running through the Grand Canyon is called the Colorado River. It stretches all the way from the Rocky Mountains of Colorado to the Gulf of California. But don't bend down too far to look at the Colorado River. Imagine what would happen if you fell. It's 1 mile deep. So watch out. When my 6-year-old brother marched to the edge of the canyon with his explorer's cap on backwards, he pointed to the other side of the canyon and asked, "Is that Canada over there?" The Grand Canyon is also home to many birds and animals. The animals might be hiding, but birds, there's a lot that you can see. There's ravens, Steller's jays, nuthatches, hummingbirds, California condors, and many more. While enjoying the magnificence of the Grand Canyon, you may also notice that all guest services and hotels don't have plastic water bottles for you to buy. But there are many water refill stations where you can refill your bottles. Nearly 5 million people visit the Grand Canyon every year. Imagine how much plastic wastage is reduced. Isn't that impressive? When I saw this, a thought came to my mind. Florida is a state full of tourist attractions. Why can't we do the same thing at Disney and other major tourist attractions to help our planet Earth? On the other hand, the Grand Canyon is the prettiest place I have ever seen. The red, orange, yellow, and a tinge of white. Even though those are dry colors, it still makes for a beautiful scenery. By the way, the Grand Canyon is a great place for pictures. OMG. My mom always asked me to pose, pose, and pose for pictures there. To tell you the truth, the Grand Canyon's grandeur is way too hard to explain. You will just have to go visit it.
So I heard my mom talking about a bucket list, and I asked her what it was.
She told me that it's a list of things that people make of things they want to do before they die. Things like skydiving or climbing to the top of Mount Everest. I thought, kids have bucket lists too. Things they want to do before they grow up, because I don't plan on dying any time soon. My folks have such different ideas on their bucket list. My mom wants to go to the Mall of America on a shopping spree, and my dad wants to ride his motorcycle all the way to South Dakota. Gee, moms and dads sure do have different ideas. Kids are much easier. So I start asking my friends and thinking of things I'll do on the kids' bucket list. Maybe we should call it a pail list since a pail is smaller than a bucket. Anyway, these are some of my awesome ideas. Number one, teach my dogs to go to the bathroom and the toilet so I have to walk them every day. Number two, be a contestant on a hole in the wall, a kid's game show. We try to go through the styrofoam wall that they have cut a shape into. Number three, meet Tony Hawk and have him teach me cool skateboarding moves, even though I'd probably fall on my butt when I try the first move he shows me. Number four, create a robot that'll clean my room for me. Who cares if I don't get an allowance? What do I need money for? I am a robot. Number five, find a place I can sleep in. It would be like camping every night. S'mores, bonfires, the stars, heaven. Number six, start a bikini eating competition so I can become the world champion candy eater. Of course, only kids can enter. Number seven, break the world record for jumps on my pogo stick. My mom always says I'm too jumpy anyway, so why not? Number eight, ride on the world's longest and biggest roller coaster, which happens to me in Japan. Hey, I'll learn to speak Japanese too. Don't worry, I got that. That's thank you in Japanese. You know, I think my pail list is much better than any grown-up's list. So, I have one question for you. What would be on your list?
The Big Apple, the city that never sleeps, NYC. What do they all have in common? All these names represent New York City. I spent my spring break. We went to Times Square, spent time with family, and went sightseeing. All I could say was, wow. I was in the center of lights and felt like I was shooting a movie. The stores there are mind-blowing. Toys R Us, M&M World, Hershey's, and the M&M store were a few of the stores I went into. Toys R Us even had a Ferris wheel that I rode with my older sisters. Now let's go to Broadway. My parents and I went to see Mary Poppins. I loved it when they spelled supercalifragilisticexpialidocious with their hands. That's Times Square, and I loved it. I was at Grand Central Station boarding a train for the first time to the town of Beacon. My family lives there. It was an adventure to cross the Hudson Walkway with them. We saw beautiful mountains. Don't have those in Florida, do we? On our last night with family, my cousin Ellen and I made dinner for everybody. We even got tips from my dad. Goodbye, family. Back on the train to the city again. Good morning, NYC. Time to see the sights. I was on top of the Rock, also known as the Rockefeller Center, sightseeing my eyes out. It took the elevator 43 seconds to go to the 67th floor. The Radio City Music Hall was gorgeous. During the tour, we got to go up on stage and meet a rockette. The NBC Studios was a blast. We visited the sets of SNL, The Today Show, and Sunday Night Football. I really enjoyed the Natural History Museum and ended the day in Central Park. My NYC adventure was unforgettable. Times Square, visiting family, and sightseeing is what I did in New York. I loved my trip to New York City, and I can't wait to go back.
I believe that vending machines are not just for high school students. Do you? Well, not everyone thinks that way. In fact, a lot of kids think that elementary students and middle school students should be allowed to have vending machine access. You're probably wondering, why should we have vending machines in our schools? Well, first of all, some kids forget their lunch money and as well as forget their lunch boxes. Raise your hand if you occasionally forget your lunch money or lunch boxes. bring your lunch to your school, right? I bet you're wondering, where am I going with this? You'll see. This is how your school can get the money for the vending machines. You and your school can organize fundraisers to pay for the machines, instead of pulling money out of the school savings account. This is the most important thing about vending machines. Kids don't have to pay money for the items technically. They would just have to punch in their student ID number that leads to their lunch account. Because students will, and I mean they will, forget money for the machine. Also, vending machines create less waste in the cafeteria. Students are more likely to throw away a tray full of food than a quick snack and drink. Also, some students get tired of the same lunch choices week after week. Vending machines can provide a greater variety of snacks, such as apples, oranges, and bananas. However, there should not be junk food in the machines, such as ding-dongs and your occasional Twinkie. Some healthy choices would be juice instead of soda, baked chips instead of fried, and instead of candy, the vending machines can provide fresh food such as apples, oranges, and bananas. Just because kids like to eat junk food doesn't mean that healthy foods can't be just as good. Don't forget the dedicated, hardworking teachers who work long hours. They would also enjoy a pick-me-up snack or juice in the afternoon. Also, some teachers have children who stay late as well. A smart pop bag of popcorn would keep them from being hungry. So, in conclusion, I believe that vending machines benefit both students and teachers. This is also a benefit to our cafeteria because less of their food goes into the trash. So, as you can see, everyone benefits from vending machines. Thank you.
With our honorable mention, and our honorable mention is Matthew Angelella from Ritchie Elementary, being my son. Our third place winner is Julia Cerliano from Trinity Oaks, my white brother. Our second place winner is Ariana Day from Indiana, the Turn Restaurant Upside Down. And our first place winner today is Selena Belcher from Gulf Highlands Elementary, with Bucket List. With our honorable mention, and our honorable mention is Matthew Angelella from Ritchie Elementary, being my son. Our third place winner is Julia Cerliano from Trinity Oaks, my white brother. Our second place winner is Ariana Day from Indiana, the Turn Restaurant Upside Down. And our first place winner today is Selena Belcher from Gulf Highlands Elementary, with Bucket List.